Okay, we are good.
Okay, I would like to call to order the work session of Wednesday, April 5th. And first, we have approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Tonight, before we take public comment, we're going to have a presentation by our city manager. And then after that, we will have public comment. We're going to limit it to kind and respectful words for 3 minutes. And remember that if you're representing a group, that you select one person to speak for you. Okay? Everybody got that? And remember, if I point like this, that means you're forgetting kindness and respect. All right? Thank you. Okay, Bruce.
Thank you, ma'am. There's really two parts to tonight's meeting, and then there's subparts for each. First thing that we want to talk about is the City Hall project. And in order for us to move forward, we need to find out what the process is that the council wants to follow to reach their decision on where City Hall and the police station or the police station. And there's really two options. I would say there's probably one option for the police station, so that's sort of a given. And then it's where to put the City Hall. Should City Hall be with the police station, or should it be here in town? So that's the first part. The next question we'll ask you is for your direction to move forward with schematic design for the two options, thinking that you're probably not going to be able to make the decision about the location tonight. You probably want some more information. And so if that's the case, what we've looked at is going to a two modified schematic designs. And while the prices are going to remain relatively relative to each other, you know, like as the price goes down, it's still going to be a gap of some sort. It's about what it is now, as far as order of magnitude. So, but we think that it might be good to go through that to find out what kind of a cost differential there really is and what the costs are more likely to be. In the meantime, we are providing you with the debt service figures as well as the total figures for any aspect, like wherever we are tonight, we're going to be able to talk about the debt service figures. The debt service, for those that don't know, that's equivalent of a mortgage payment or something. It's how much does it cost us a year, as opposed to how much does the house cost over 30 years. So that's where the work will be going through on the City Hall project. Next is we have four scenarios for the Cannon Beach Elementary. We start all the way back at the ZCS document, and we've updated it in terms of cost. We've updated it in terms of adding soft costs, those kind of things. And that's like the first one, because historically that's the first one. And then we have a base project for the Cannon Beach Elementary. And that's a little bit more than that. And then there's another that does some things like creates the central space, the logic connection to the building. There's the one that has already been discussed, which is the program that we went through working with citizens, and this is what was requested, and that's what we put together for you for your first look. So that's how the process will go. And if that's acceptable to you all, otherwise, if you have another approach you want to take, you could do that. But we thought that getting into what the skill levels are, relative levels are, and then asking for the direction to be able to start schematic design, maybe about to the 50% point with both sites, you want us to do that. We can do that also, or we can just focus on a single site when you're ready. So with that, with the information will be presented by both the architect and the construction manager. They both worked on these presentations together, and we can talk about a process at which costs would be reduced by removing certain elements. Both projects are at a point where the costs are based on, say, square footage or something, as opposed to the cost of the counter in the kitchen. There's a cost, it's an allowance for the kitchen. So it's hard to say, well, if you use this type of oven versus this type of oven, it doesn't make, you're not there yet. But they're kind of gross numbers that we can work from as we go through, build detail to either one yet. And clearly the Cannon Beach Elementary is further along in design than the City Hall Police Station. Are there any questions? Okay, thank you.
So do we want their presentations?
I would prefer that we do those presentations so everybody has the same information.
Okay.
Okay, so let's start. Leslie, do you want to start with Jordan?
Sure. So we don't have a new graphic presentation for you this evening. I think you are aware of our efforts to date. And so, as Bruce mentioned, what we are hoping to understand is our next steps. So where we take design from here in terms of these two site options, and at what point the decision could be made as to focus on one site or another. Bruce also mentioned, and I can let Jordan speak to this, but the costs that have been presented to date are based merely on approximate size of building. So a square footage cost without design and a large contingency associated with that. As we move through design, that contingency will be refined as we know more about the design decisions being made. Bruce also mentioned that the difference between the two is likely to stay relative. So as we move through design and can make economic decisions, find efficiencies, and potentially to some degree sharpen our pencil and decrease those costs, they will decrease likely proportionally on both sites.
I'll take it. So just to kind of reiterate and kind of refresh everybody's memory, we have option one and option two. Option one, internal to our team, is City Hall at Gower, PD at Cash, and that's one option that we priced out. Mm-hmm. Option two is both pieces of program up at the Cash site. So if I say option one or option two instead of where the sites are located, that's what that means. We're not as far along as the elementary school project, so really our estimates are based on square footage and the sites. And there is some function of time built into those as well. But we did find that there was a premium of about $3 million to split the two pieces of program. And really that premium, and I think maybe that's some of the focus that we'll talk about today, is the duplicity of program and functions. So for example, you have City Hall here and PD up there, you have two parking lots, you have two sets of utilities, two landscape functions, not to mention two mechanical systems, electrical systems, IT systems. So that's kind of the duplicity of breaking those up and where that premium comes from. The other piece in splitting them up and doing City Hall here is there's a temp facilities piece, a move out, a relocation piece that we have to factor in, and then also the demolition of this building. So those are the main premiums that we're facing by splitting the two pieces of program up versus putting everything up at the Cash site. I mentioned time as a function, and it's really unknown right now, but if we're able to do both projects at the same time, then that condenses the time frame of construction. If for some reason the projects need to be linear, i.e. building PD at Cash, relocating PD up there, and then starting this project, it makes our construction project longer, which obviously has cost implications as well. Those haven't been fully vetted, but it is something to consider.
Anybody have any questions?
At what point do you envision being able to do exploratory work to figure out substrate underneath this location and the cache site?
Geotechnical services, so on. So I'll let you take that one.
I can take that one. So we currently have a geotech proposal and survey proposal on the table to further investigate. When we reached out to the geotech company who did the to work on the Southwind site, which is adjacent, they installed a few years ago equipment to measure the landslide risk there. And our, what we're currently looking at is bringing them back to the site to measure their, to take readings on their equipment so that we have more information on that landslide risk. And then from there, it would be getting a new full geotech report. So those are items we've been proceeding with independent of this decision on option one or option two, because of the likelihood of the police department being constructed on the cache site.
So nothing here?
We have an older geotech report here that we would need updated should we opt to use this site for the city hall. But because we have that older report, we had more information for preliminary ideas about the foundation system required, and that's what we used to price.
Okay. I have a proposal for that too. We're updating here.
Yes, but I assume if we decide not to choose this site that
Right. That's why we've held off on following through with that.
Do you have any idea how long it's going to take before we get that information up there?
The reading of the equipment up at the cache site could be done within a number of weeks from giving them the okay for that. There would then be another step after that to get the full geotech report, but that would be the first step that could happen fairly quickly.
Would it be realistic to build police department emergency operations center at the cache site and then phase the city hall, a second phase also at the cache site? What would be the implications of that?
It is something we often do with projects, a sort of phased approach that way. Gordon alluded to there being costs associated to that. Similar, if you built the police station there and city hall here at a later time, if we phased it but kept them both at the cache site, there would be some cost implications and design implications to make sure we understand how that phasing would work, whether this is phased such that it's a building addition potentially and we design it structurally for expansion, or whether this is phased in a way that there are two buildings. There's a few ways that could play out.
I would offer that there's potentially a third, to where you build the entire structure to house both City Hall and PD, but the City Hall portion of that is structure only. So you're getting the economies of scale of building the structure while we're there, but the full build out would happen at a later time. Whereas I would offer that as a third.
I'm not sure there would be any cost savings associated with that.
No, I'm sure there aren't.
No.
We do have the, because we have another site, it does give us the opportunity, again, because it's likely the police station first, that they could stay here until that project is done. And same thing, if both City Hall and the police station go up there, we could stay. Although the move-in could be phased a little bit. We also have the opportunity to have portables or something out here, so we can completely clear this building so that it can be taken down and then the work could go on while we're working remotely. That's probably a little bit, well, it's more inefficient and probably a little bit higher cost.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you.
I just have one of you folks. We suggested, and what I presented this earlier on, that we go to maybe a certain level of preliminary design for both, if that information would help you. It might help you because it would be more refined, but we're not going to find that the costs likely go this way, in the opposite of what they are now as far as the relative cost. And that was suggested as a way, if it would help you, to make the decision that we could get some more information than we have now. But the relative information would stay the same. But we really can't, other than spending the money to do two schematic designs, there's not a lot we could do to help with the decision, other than if you want to split it that way, or if you say, well, I really like this one, so let's start that one and see where we end up with it. But we do need a decision as soon as possible, then we can get more in depth for whichever option you choose.
Okay, thank you.
All right.
Dustin?
Thank you. So we've taken the last week and came up with an approach tonight to bring to you what this project could be if we started to dial back some of the elements. We wanted to limit the number of options that we showed you. There's just an infinite number of ways to present this. So we've basically done it in, as Bruce talked about before, the ZCS option, and then three options as priced by Remick. Again, I don't want CETA's and Remick, we're not proposing any of these more cost-effective options. After going through the programming phase, there's a lot that these don't touch upon. I'd also like to say that this is going to be the first time that any and tribe, and there's a number of them tonight, have seen these exhibits, and quite possibly be disheartening after the programming that we've gone through. So with that said, I think what we'll do is I'm going to go ahead and share my screen.
Yep.
Pete's getting ready to share the screen. One of the things that we're all looking at as the options were being developed is you have to reach a certain point before you can say that this would be usable as everything prior to that is a little bit more of a, well, you'll see them, but a little bit of a harder sell to go ahead and say that that's actually what could happen there. So keep that in mind when we're looking.
Right, so how these exhibits are broken up, these four options as described. So this is the 2020 budget as put together by the firm ZCS, and what they described as their level four package, which in their description was to accommodate some level of tourism related facility. That number, and David, I should probably let you speak to this, but the overall numbers are to the right. Beneath that, it's broken out between construction and soft costs. At this level of providing estimates, the soft costs, we're using 30% as a rule of thumb on all these.
Yeah, and I'll talk about the construction. So I was able to take the ZCS estimate and level it against our estimate, the base package level. And we were able to look at inflation rates and come up with a proportionate inflation rate to take the ZCS estimate and bring it to the 2023 cost. And so you'll notice that our base package is actually lower than the ZCS estimate. A couple of notes on that. One, the abatement and the roof replacement has already been completed. That was about $750,000. So if you subtract that out of the ZCS estimate, it's roughly the same number. As Dustin mentioned, this is a very limited package, so there's no center lobby component. It's rehabbing the existing gym and the classrooms in their current state for the most part. It does include updating utilities to the street. So a whole new HVAC, plumbing, electrical system.
Go ahead and bring that up.
And then a very modest landscape package in site. Pretty much just where we impact the site, we'd be replacing with the current code requirements.
Hey, Dustin.
So with each of these, is that big enough there, Bruce?
Yeah.
These were not intended to look stark. We've had a week since our last meeting. We'll make anything look good. That's the easy part.
These are exhibits to give you a sense of scale and what you're going to get for your money.
Again, this is the ZCS one. We've had to make some interpolations based on what they've accounted for on a line item basis. For example, $50,000 for landscaping and not having much more detail than that, having to try to draw comparisons, apples to apples, so that we can present them adjacent to Bremix. So we've tried to keep them the same as far as what you get for the money between Bremix base estimate and ZCS's estimate. There's about, we're expecting approximately 15 to 16,000 square feet of disturbed area due to construction activities. And that area will need to be brought back to its pre-existing conditions. And so basically for that $50,000, you get that plus your City of Cannon Beach required right-of-way landscaping.
Okay.
Can you talk a little bit about the infrastructure included in this?
Yeah, so both buildings would receive an HVAC system, which currently isn't in either building right now. We would replace the electrical back to the main utility connection, so probably an underground vault with new circuit building, new panels, circuitry. And plumbing also back to the main point of connection in the street with new restrooms, fixtures, and new ADA compliant restroom spaces.
And we're still on ZCS.
Sorry?
We're still on the ZCS.
Oh, sorry. That was under our base package. Under the ZCS package, that did not include upgraded utilities from what I could tell in their numbers. And that was to reuse existing, but make it ADA compliant. So larger restroom spaces connect onto the existing infrastructure, which we're not sure the quality of at this time. And that's as much as I can make out of their estimate. It did include new walls, updated drywall throughout, carpet or resilient flooring based on their budgets, and then new ceilings. And then the gym did have a new gym floor with probably some associated finishes for the basketball hoop.
And then they did have in theirs a sprinkler system for the gym itself. There was a broken out option where they provided a firewall at the classroom building along the eastern edge there that could potentially allow you to forego a sprinkler system, but with pretty heavy limitations on occupancy.
Can one of you go over why the building might have to be sprinkled or not sprinkled?
Sure. So with this type of occupancy that's proposed for this building, just a standard gym is something that we would call an A3 occupancy. With this being a tourism-related facility that goes to food and beverage consumption, it's an A2 occupancy. A2 occupancy is limited to 5,000 square feet or 100 occupants, whichever is more stringent before it triggers the fire sprinkler. The footprint of the gym building is 7,500 square feet. But regardless, if you think that we weren't going to get to that 100 occupant threshold from a what we call a design occupant, with the how the code makes us calculate those occupant loads, we're way over.
the building official could say, yeah, you know what, let's allow you to use the actual proposed based on any given events. Even if that were to happen, 100 occupant threshold, we're still over that 5,000 square foot threshold fire area.
I do not believe that not sprinkling the gym building and probably also
the classroom building, especially if we connect them, is going to be feasible and still be able to use this place as a tourism related facility. So we've advised Bremick to go ahead and include that in their base costs, a baseline option. So this site plan,
as rough as it is again, just kind of to give you an idea of scale of what's included versus not.
That was the $7,016,490 option. The next option is Bremick's base package. And this is without the heritage package. And what that means is without the CBE lobby that connects the two buildings.
You'll see that their number, as David was alluding to a little bit earlier, it's about $750,000 less than ZCS's package, but ZCS has already, that portion of scope of work as far as the re-roof for the classroom buildings already taken place.
So if you back that up, now we're looking at approximate apples to apples in terms of what you saw on the site plan for ZCS and what you're going to see here in the site plan for Bremick's baseline option.
So you can kind of see all this whited out area from our schematic design. All that is not included. So what is included? Again, it's the same like for like landscaping. How far does $50,000 go? It goes to 15 to 16,000 square feet of reseeded impact area due to construction on site, and then right-of-way plantings, and that's about it.
On the inside, the only infrastructure piece that ZCS's, well, two infrastructure pieces that ZCS's budget included was a new HVAC system throughout, and our HVAC engineering consultant has gone through and said, absolutely, it needs to be new throughout. There's no life left in the existing. ZCS also had some level of upgrade to the existing electrical. It was a pretty small number. So I'm left to kind of interpolate how much of an upgrade that actually was. I think it is just to replace the existing panel like for like,
and then new
circuitry throughout. So not upsizing the existing service.
You want to talk about what's in here?
Yeah, so in our base package, I started talking about earlier, but so it does include new utilities throughout, connecting back to the main and the street. As I mentioned, new electrical service, a larger service to feed more panels inside the buildings, a new plumbing system, so all fixtures will be replaced. New bathrooms throughout to make them ADA compliant. It would include some seismic upgrades where it as needed, and the report on that is to come. And then new finish upgrades throughout both buildings. So gym floor in the gym, which also include in the gym would include multiple bathrooms and storage spaces for equipment. The classroom building would pretty much stay the same. A limited number of walls could be added, but mostly rehabbing what's there, new carpet, paint, acoustics, and then leaving the canopy on the north side of the classroom building.
I do want to reiterate something real quick, and that is we're talking about, you know, the ZCS option being 7 million. And then you reduce it by 750,000 to account for scope that's already been completed. That's the re-roof and limited
seismic rehab up at the roof level.
You're back down to around 650,000. Their estimate at the time was lower than that. And David, I'm hoping you can talk to how we got that number from 2020 up to where it is now, the
5.397.
Yes, yeah, so we used a factor of 1.35 or 35% increase in construction costs for the past 3 years to reach that number. So that's why it's showing at 5.3 to as we leveled the costs out from 2020 to 2023. And then we use that number to then apply the soft costs, which were not, as far as I could tell, were not included in their initial base estimate. Even though it set it below the line, there was still 30% missing in the numbers I couldn't find. So that's what the soft cost rate is against each one of those numbers.
Yeah, and that soft cost is rule of thumb of 10%, which is right in the average zone for public projects.
Great. The next option, which would be the second
option that Bremick
priced.
Same as option two.
However, this
time including the CBE lobby in between the classroom building
and the gym building.
And
this addition, it's priced in this budget
how it has been proposed in schematic design.
Really, the only thing I think directly
adjacent to the addition that's not captured in this is going to be any kind of
canopies
leading into or exiting
the building.
So it's just kind of its
infill piece
in between the two structures. Anything I'm missing?
No, that's right. And then some modifications to the site. So a little bit bigger site package, resealing the driveway that's out there now. Upgrading the concrete sidewalk out in front of both buildings. And the budget allowed for some more plantings along the site as well.
So instead of in the previous two versions, we looked at between 15 and 16,000 square feet of just reseeding to bring the site back to pre-construction conditions. This budget allows taking 2,000 square feet of that, not including the right-of-way plantings for additional heritage garden or other types of
trees and shrubs, right. Not just seeding.
And then the last option is the option as presented throughout schematic design.
And
I don't know that we need to spend much time on that, but the
11.9.
We haven't taken any.
So it's the schematic design package as has been presented
in COE number 7 a couple of weeks ago.
Questions?
Well, I have a question. Just something I'm nervous about. There's not been any kind of exploration of asbestos or lead or lead pipes or mold at the site yet. Has there been or has there been?
Yeah, no, it's been investigated and remediated. There's no contaminants left on the site. It's already done.
How do you know about lead though? Unless you go into the you've gone into the walls.
It was a testing company that was hired by the city. And they take samples of the paint, all those things.
And what about the plumbing, the pipes? They were going to all be replaced or?
Replaced.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Okay. Is there any way we can get some written information regarding what is involved in all of the options?
Yeah, we can.
It's a little confusing, the first and second options, especially, it's a little confusing as to what is included in the first option and what's included in the second and why the second one is less than the first one.
That is confusing. And to answer your question, yes, we can get you a written narrative for each of those exhibits.
To add to that, the first option is more of a reference point to these ZCS. So we wouldn't, that was their estimate. And we just tried to make it apples to apples to our baseline estimate. as best we could. So one and two are effectively the same starting place. What is included in our estimate, which we could not determine in ZCS's estimate, don't believe to be true, is that we will upgrade all utilities back to the main line. So from what we can tell right now, most of the utilities are shot. There's not an opportunity to reuse them.
And on that note, we have had a pre-application conference City Cannon Beach's Public Works, and really is not an option to leave the existing plumbing. It has to come out. So that appears to be a large line item that's missing from the ZCS budget that we need to account for. The other thing too is we're going through this process now during the schematic design phase to see if we can acquire 18 feet of the Beaver Street right of way to be part of the CBE rejuvenation site. And that gives us what appears to be on-site stalls would be off street, or excuse me, they appear to be on street, but they would be considered off street and lend towards us meeting that code requirement. It does other things. It allows us to have a more meaningful entry from the Southeast Plaza into the site through the Heritage Lobby. So I mentioned that because when you look at the graphics between, you know, the first and second one, here's again ZCS's option. When I skip over to the next option, that's Bremick's baseline option. You see all that dark gray down here? That's what that is. That's that additional 18 feet that they've been able to capture as new, basically half street improvements, even though they're largely on site.
I have a question about 3. So no kitchen, and that's where the building is just open. The whole thing is open.
Yeah, so that option 3 is kind of without some of the bonus components of the complete package. So it doesn't have the overhead doors at the end of the gym that would open up. It doesn't have the kitchen. There is not any improvements to the rest of the site. So
no other classrooms.
Classrooms.
Just exact same configuration. Same
configuration, no operable partition that opens up the two classrooms into one large one.
And it eliminates all of the covered areas.
What would the siding be like in those options?
We did include new siding, cedar shake siding on the classroom building and a new roof on the gym, metal panel roof on the gym. There is an option to do a shingle system on the gym, like a comp asphalt, but that would be another value engineering step. And we haven't really discussed the total impact of that design wise.
And then what about either at the north and south ends of the gym? Siding.
New cedar shake siding on that yet. But does not include new storefront systems on either side or the overhead doors that would allow for the events to kind of flow out into the park.
But the whole window facade on the classroom building would need to be?
We'd replace that with an upgraded storefront or window system and new doors. New storefront doors were appropriate to enter the gym, most likely in the existing. Well, if it's option 3, we'd tie it into the Heritage Lobby, and then new doors on all the classrooms.
Okay.
Yeah. So in all options, even the ZCS, you know, basic option includes an energy upgrade, and what that means is the building envelope is going to be upgraded to meet insulation requirements. And that does include air infiltration, so a new weather barrier between the new siding and the building structure.
And then anywhere where there is existing
windows or storefront systems, those would be replaced with new storefront systems or window systems that meet current energy code.
So the first 3 options include removing the loft area on the north of the gym, but then just finishing it. There's no doors, windows, it's just sited.
beyond what's existing. That's correct.
And the classroom area, would that be the way it is now with the configuration of the classrooms the way they are now, not doors leading into each classroom, but the way they...
There's probably some flexibility to add a door here or there, but you do want to look at the program to see if that made sense, you know, to allow them all to open to each other or...
I don't think the needle moves very far on that base option if, because we have to do a seismic upgrade on that building. The only seismic upgrade that's been done has been at the roof level. So now we have to go from that level down. And when we do that, if you look at the south face of the gym, it's mostly glass. Well, that doesn't work so well for lateral movement. So we have to account for that. So what that means is we're going to end up with windows that are this big right now that end up being this big. There's still nice sized openings. Instead of having 2 feet of solid wall in between, you're going to probably have 5 feet or 6 feet in between.
But no doors leading out to the south. And
but you can't, I mean, at that point, we're already having to replace the storefront systems.
So replacing the storefront system, an old one with a new storefront system to include a door, again, you're not really seeing the needle move much on that.
I think it's also something we'll have to look at from fire code. Whether or not you can go from one room into another, usually you can't get out. So that might drive some of the decisions. I have some other information that may be of value to you in your deliberation. You probably want to grab a pen. But this information will be in Bremic sends to you. The city, we gave the price of 1.555 million as the debt service for the combined city hall and police station at the cash site. We didn't give you one for just, I'm sorry, I have to clarify this with the people that gave it to me. So let's go to the first one, which is the ZCS level 4. The debt service for that is $432,334.
You mean number one?
Number one, yes. Okay. Yes, I'm sorry.
Could you read that off again?
Yes. For ZCS level 4, which is what I called it at the time I request, $432,334. Okay. The next one is a little lower, which is number two. And that was $392,621. That was the base level provided by Bremen. Level three, we're ready, is $608,849. And there's been a little bit of a change in the price on the debt service for the option that's already been presented, and that's now $728,700. We've also asked for some information on 40-year for City Hall. I think City Hall would be a reasonable to do a 40-year loan on. I wouldn't do it for the other two buildings.
How come, Bruce?
I think that building new to category four or risk category four is going to give you a very strong building, much longer life than probably what the what we would be able to get from retrofitted buildings. Okay. Although we can ask the question as to whether or not somebody would do a loan on it. The new construction, I think, and much stronger than pretty much anything else that's getting built.
The expected lifetime.
Yes.
Of the building.
Yeah. Okay. 25 million over 30 years is $1,555,000. And 40 years, $1,422,800. And the difference is $132,200 is what the annual debt service would be. Lower.
You consider that a significant savings?
I do, especially over 30 years. I have a concern of moving City Hall up to the cash site. Just because it could be, in many ways, it could be, I was mentioning to these folks, it could be in Tigard. It's quite a distant situation. It's off on its own. People can find their way there, but it doesn't have the same kind of presence as what this building has. You know, you can walk to, you can come by, whatever. So the difference of I think that the $132,000 would be enough for me to give some extra consideration to putting it here.
Per year?
Yeah, it's per year. And
do you realize 10 years of savings or 40 years of savings of $130,000?
Mark, the savings would be if we built there.
Yes.
This is actually a cost to have it. Well, no, see, this is the 40 and 30 year. Let me get the verify my numbers, and we'll include it in that report. But that's the difference. But I think it's an increase to be in this location. I'll get the correct number for you.
Okay.
Other questions before we take public comment? Anything else? Either of you would like to add the two projects?
I think the only thing I would add, you know, in looking at these numbers before you tonight, I think a lot of what you find in the essence of what is the CBE rejuvenation project is realized in that last $2 million. I think there's just, I made the comment about, you know, these images maybe being disheartening to our members of the tribe who are able to join us tonight.
Could you speak up just a little?
You bet. There's an infinite number of ways to break up the slices, you know, of how we present to spend this money. But I think what you find is that for that 9.9 million, that next option down, you lose a lot of the canvas for the history of that site to be told in all its forms, whether it's tribal, whether it's Lewis and Clark, whether, so I think that if there's one thing I could leave you with tonight, it's that the magic ends happening in that last $2 million.
I think from my perspective, I would like to just preemptively thank you for the direction that will ultimately be given here. I want to acknowledge that the decision that we're asking is a hard one, that there are competing priorities here, and there is no, as far as I'm concerned, I can definitely see the pros and the cons of both of these. And so, again, I acknowledge this is a difficult decision, and thank you for your input.
Thank you.
Got one more question that I just thought of.
Go ahead, Brandon. Sure.
If you were to, at this point, or perhaps later, be able to offer some advice about how we could save money versus having the City Hall and Police Station built at the cash site, and then the other option, having the Police Station built at the cash site and the City Hall here. Which of those two options do you feel would have the best ability to save money? We get to the point, as you spoke of, pencil sharpening happens.
Mm-hmm. Do you want
to? Sorry to put you on the spot about
that. I'll go first. I think the best opportunity is both programs up at the cache site, because you have one structure, you have one set of program that you can focus on and make cuts at one time. I don't know if that made sense, but
it does.
Yeah, I mean you have one place to focus our efforts is up at the cache site if both programs are up there on the VE side of things.
It doesn't make my decision any easier.
Sure.
It makes it harder, as a matter of fact, but I appreciate your
answer. Thank you. There was one other piece when I was talking about the duplicity of things, and maybe it ties into your VE question as well, but having both programs on two different sites, we have a total of about 15 or 16,000 square feet. You reminded me of it when you brought up the geotech. So there's going to be ground improvements that are going to be required at both sites. If you split the programs up, you have single story structures at both sites. So the total of 15,000 square feet, 16,000 square feet of ground improvements. The plan for City Hall and PD at the cache site is a two-story site with a 7,500, half the square footage is 7,500 square foot. So it actually is a savings on the ground improvements up at the cache site as well. And I know that probably doesn't help your decision either, but I did want to relay that information.
But there's $3 million in savings that we know to put them together at the cache site, or at least as much as we can know.
We can tell
you. At this point.
Correct.
And I don't know if this is part why you were asking, but where are we more likely to run into cost overruns, or do you just not know? And it could be either.
Getting updated the cost overruns really start at the ground and then reduce as you move your way up, right? So the biggest unknown is what's below us. So getting an updated geotech here and a new geotech at the cache site would really give us a lot of clarity. It's kind of really the biggest unknown. And then that's going to drive structure, ground improvements. And then again, your risk for unknowns decreases as you move up through the structure.
So our decision becomes, do we want to check both of them or commit to one site or both?
That is in fact our choice, yes. Plus, I guess since it hasn't been said tonight, but it has been said in the past that we will have a savings if we built at the cache site of being able to stay here and not have to pay for something somewhere else.
During construction.
Exactly. And I don't know what that number is.
We actually looked at the an assessment of the property, this property one time, for that very question. And we will pull it out and send it. I'm sure it's no longer accurate, but that's another decision the council could make as to whether or not you're going to use this property to enhance Midtown, to add parking, or to sell the upland part up here as a cost offset to the project.
I think more to my point is that, do you have any idea what the cost would be if we were to have to rent something somewhere else in order to function as a city hall?
Yes.
This spot would be construction.
And Jordan, didn't you include that in the estimate?
Yeah, in our initial estimate, we were carrying about $250,000. It was unknown, but it was figuring that we were going to have to put temp trailers, facilities, all out in this parking lot, get them hooked up to utilities, and then whatever the rental cost was for the duration of the project at the cache site.
Okay, I remember now.
Yeah,
thank you.
And another downside to that is
no
parking for a year.
Yes.
Okay, we're ready for public comment.
Thank you, Paul.
Yeah, thank you.
We're going to do a public comment, and there are we going to talk about it, or are we going to listen and come back?
I think we should listen first.
Yeah.
Okay.
But we will talk about it after we listen to them. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. I want to remind people, public comment 3 minutes or less would be appreciated. 3 minutes is solid, but be kind and respectful, and remember that we all have the best interests, Cannon Beach, and projects. Okay, who would like to start? Probably after that, nobody wants to talk, right? Okay, Tim.
Take someone to get the ball rolling.
May I distribute?
Sure.
Yeah.
It goes, it counts on your 3 minutes, so start running.
Okay. Yeah, would you help me?
Yeah.
Thank you. Distribute around. I'm Tim Ramey, 628 Oak Street. I've spoken before. I'm in favor of certainly doing the Cannon Beach Elementary School project as presented, the 11.9. I would reiterate that the magic is $2 million. Let's get the magic. But the most important thing there is that that's the one that's easiest to fund. We can fund that one. It's harder to fund the police station and the city hall, but we've got money coming at us with the TLT fund, and we would be not wise to invest it when we raised all that money to do that. This little piece I handed around is kind of a dream sheet, and it's think of it as a template. I talked to Bruce earlier today. We're going to work on this with the third quarter numbers. So in a couple of weeks, we'll get an iteration of this that will include third quarter, and hopefully we'll get better guidance on what the true reserves need to be. I'm making this up, so these numbers are wrong. Please don't hold me to that. But it's a template. It's a way to think about it. So for instance, our general fund went up by 55% in 6 months. That's pretty cool. Now, we know that we were comfortable at 3.6 million. So we're probably pretty comfortable letting a couple million of that 5.6 million go. But how much of that 3.6 million do we actually need in that general reserve? Let's ask that question just right down the line. There's all kinds of things I don't know, don't understand, need an explanation. Lori's going to have to fill us in on these things. But if we can do this, we can drill down on this, and you can see you get to a pretty big number. This is searching for coins in the cushions of the couch, but those coins are adding up to almost $9 million. So again, we've got an income statement approach. Bruce has presented debt service, which is all about cash flow. This is a balance sheet approach to say, yeah, but we don't need to carry these balances in our balance sheet. There's too much in the way of reserves here. And this would be a wise time to appropriate some of them, three funds or three projects. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tim.
Next.
Eric Ostrander, PO Box 97. I had prepared some stuff basically around funding stuff because that's what was in the agenda. Thank you guys for presenting some additional information for the projects themselves. The things that I wanted to address was things that were in the packet that were mentioned specifically about TLT, that comparing Cannon Beach to other cities with TLT. And I felt that was leaving something missing, that there's no mention of the prepared food tax in the packet, that's also something that visitors to town are paying. So people that are staying in the hotels are paying 8% tax and 5% on foods that they're purchasing while they're in town. So that's something to go into consideration of looking at TLT for a source that visitors are not only paying for TLT, they're also paying for that PFT while they're here. Let me see. So I kind of looked through the down when the mention of the property tax increase, that $1.95 per million borrowed, and looking at the 25 million with the numbers, I didn't do math on the numbers that were presented tonight, but the numbers were presented at the last meeting, that there was an approximately $11 million shortfall of principal that needed to be paid for the $25 million project total for if the site was split for City Hall and police station. And that $11 million If the numbers in the packet were correct, at $1.95 per $1 million on a $500,000 assessment, that comes out to $21.45 with the $11 million shortfall. So $22 basically per year of an increase in property tax is what, if the numbers are correct based on the last numbers that were presented by Bruce. And then the third comment I had is about parking. There's a big section of the packet, I can't remember how many pages, 30 some pages, that were all about the paid parking. And I would implore you to have a real serious conversation with Chief Jason and about what enforcement and what he needs for enforcement, if that's going to be a route to go down. Because I know they're already strapped for officers. They're strapped, especially in the summertime, the amount of effort that it takes to keep up with them, the resources that he has at his disposal. And to add enforcement of this to it would be a real question for the police officers. Thank you.
Thanks, Eric. And thanks for making the point that was per million, the $21 or whatever it was.
The $1.95 per million.
Right. That was a per million out of all the way through. Okay.
Yeah, thank you. So the $11 million shortfall. So then multiply that by 11. So $20.
All right. That was good analysis. Thank you.
Okay. Next. Deb. Okay. You'll be up.
Hi, my name is Deb Atia, P.O. Box 1426, Cannon Beach. I'm speaking as a citizen and as a voter and a taxpayer tonight. So Cannon Beach is one of the top destinations in the world, and I think we have to keep that in mind to think of that image and something to be proud of. I've heard a lot of fear of the school budget being over budget. Most projects come in over budget, but the inflation affecting everything, people are really concerned. Somehow they must be reassured, and I think you're doing a good job. I also think these two companies, I've looked them up extensively on their websites, and I'm very impressed that they know what they're doing, and I have total faith in their abilities. Instead of complaining, we need people to focus on the ideas and solutions with finding a way forward. I've heard, how will we maintain the school after it's built? Manager has to be paid. What is the plan? Where will those funds come from? Will it be empty most of the time or not used? I've heard that some of the businesses do not see the value of the school and that they need to be sold on the idea of how it will benefit the customers in the larger community. Where are people going to park is a huge concern. And something we should all be supporting is the Cannon Beach Food Pantry. Their building needs to be remodeled as they are helping so many people in our community. Last month, 299 families with 981 people, including 27 new families, were served through the food pantry. I don't know if you're aware of that, but that's pretty, we're doing a story this week on that. The funding for the Federal Supplement Nutrition Program, known as SNAP, is decreasing 45% back to pre-pandemic levels, while the need is increasing. The food pantry serves 65 to 70 families per week, and the period from March 2022 to March 2023 saw a 50% increase in the number of families being served. As one business owner told me, it's going to take many sources to fund these projects. Paid parking should probably be addressed and considered, is the way he said. And the old grade school is supposed to become a wonderful place for people to gather. We need to explain why it will be good for Cannon Beach. People want to feel like they have been heard, and I'm hearing them. And we need to focus on what's right instead of what's wrong. I think that's really important. And that's all I have to say. And I made it in 3 months.
Thank you.
Yes. If I can, to your comment, Deb, about the food pantry, we are probably going to change the scope of services for both CETA and Bremic and have them put together something for us to do the project to upgrade the food pantry, but it would be paid for out of general fund, that particular part of the project. But when this is done, the food pantry will be taken care of, again, outside of the tourism side of the funding.
Okay, good. That's good to know.
Okay.
I also made a list of all the things the school would be good for and the possibilities for candidate. So if anybody wants a copy or they want an email, I thought of everything I could possibly.
Okay, thanks, Deb. You're coaching onto somebody else. Okay, I think that. You sure?
Yes.
You're waving it again? Or just your turn?
No, I'm not waving.
Okay, Lolly. Go ahead. Hey, come on.
Hi, Lolly Champion, P.O. Box 14, Cannon Beach. Kind of speaking to what Deb just spoke about. After the March 28th meeting, I sent an email out in haste and anger. The next morning, I sent an apology. I will again state, as I did in my apology, never push send while angry. My apology, however, did not change the fact that the well-researched and knowledgeable statements from the community about the state of the three building projects that were thoughtfully and fact-laden were ignored by the Gazette. As far as I know, there has been no outreach to any of the presenters who asked questions and hoped for answers from council members. The concerns, objections, numerous costly areas still not recognized or calculated, and the millions of dollars over projected budgets remain unsettled and continue to grow as a major issue for the community. All that has been said before, yet whenever these unresolved, undeveloped areas missing from the major projects are presented as questions or stated facts, there are responses that add more separation between questionnaires and the council, city staff, and a few of the Gazette staff. I believe the concerns of the community through emails, copy with the councilors, public comment times are not divisive. They are rightful and thoughtful questions that shouldn't be answered with another PowerPoint or another, where were you earlier and why didn't you ask sooner? There are sustainable, ongoing opportunities for the type of open public comment period Mayor Knopf and the council accommodated last week. Consider a follow-up meeting in the evening so businesses and residents may attend with council responding with answers, or we don't know, but we'll find out. This type of meeting may occur when there are city issues that are large expenditures and debt obligations, city-altering projects, and areas of public interest and concern like the environment, wetlands and tree protection, and workforce housing, water and sewer infrastructure, and what's throwing public restrooms and parking. I received a number of responses this week from community neighbors, a lot of responses, and they all spoke highly of the Wantstown Halls meetings that were at the Coaster. Perhaps this is a time to return to the town hall format for the growing concerns of the community and for the council, who thankfully are dedicated there. And I also want to take a moment to thank you for explaining to so many of the residents what's happening and giving us the visual look too. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Lolly.
Anna Hammond, P.O. Box 942. First of all, I want to thank you. I believe that I was maybe a little harsh last week, and I certainly didn't mean to be. The project is beautiful. Unfortunately, it's not something that I feel our community can afford at the full scale. And Deb, Atiya is right. All people need to be heard, even those that don't agree with your opinion. And I also agree with Wally that I really feel that we need to go to a town hall so more voices can be heard. It's a more neutral setting. Brandon, you had questioned the difference between a 30 and a 40 year note. We talk about annual debt service. We don't talk about overall interest. The difference in that quick math is about $10 million in interest if you go to a 40 year term. We've heard a lot of what ifs. What if we get a grant for this? What if we get a grant for this? What if we do this? We don't have time for what ifs. We need hard answers so you guys can make educated decisions. I did look over the narrative. It was finally made available to us. There are some questions regarding some of the exclusions that is on the record that it would be great if you guys could answer, just so we have that information. What if this does happen? How much is this going to cost us? You know, just those kinds of things. Not meant in a bad way, just so we can truly be informed about what that means. I do have these emails with me if you guys would like a copy of it, and that it would just be easier for you. So there's this, I just kind of wanted to follow up on the email that I sent. Councillor Hayes asked last week, where do we find the money? I truly, honestly believe that it is not where do we find the money, but how do we get back within our budget? And what is that budget? I think it's unfortunate that possibly a budget wasn't given on some of these projects. I could be completely wrong. Another thing that has been brought to my attention, and again, it could just be hearsay, but it's definitely something that we probably should know the answer to. And the Southwind property, the road up there, there's an easement. I understand that that easement only is for emergency vehicles and not through traffic. And the owner of the property is not real keen on a bunch of people driving up there. So that has been brought to my attention. It was brought to my attention. So I think it's really important that that is looked into. I thank you all for your time, and I hope y'all have a good evening. And I really wish we could afford that beautiful bridge. Thank you, everyone. Next.
Deanna is correct. There is a restriction on the access at Fulton on the main line. It will be a challenge to either renegotiate that or figure out a way around it. This is a cost that has not been mentioned that we really need to consider in the process. It's one of the reasons why when we were looking at the total of Southwind, the access was further north on the Option 101. Access, from what I recall, is variable to how many car trips are planned. So the less project, less trips, less of an access, something like that. But research is going to have to happen on that because it is dramatic. That's on the City Hall project. I would talk about what Dustin said about the magic in the project is the last 2 million. The magic of the project, all those components are also the components primarily that can garnish grants, donations, volunteer funding, volunteer help. And many of them, mostly the landscaping ones, are things that need to evolve. They need to grow into what they are, like a garden grows in what it is. So many of those are things that I would actually strongly think would be better served allowing to evolve after the project is up and running. That's basically the component that I was talking about. I think there's a little bit of a disconnect from, let's see, project three to four, because it's either a component out of number four that goes into three and makes it different. There's no reiteration, no rethinking of what is involved inside and how it works. Granted, that's not a lot of cost difference, but it is some. So rather than being handed four menu items, you need to look at it as a smorgasbord. All these different items that could be laid back.
Thanks,
Sam.
Thanks, Sam.
Anybody else? Is there anyone on Zoom, Rusty?
Jan has her hand up, looks like.
Oh, I'm sorry, Jan. Okay, and then we'll get to the people on Zoom, so be patient and kind and respectful.
I'm Jan Siebert-Warman, 778 Cannon Beach. I just wanted to talk a bit very briefly about something that came to me while I was listening to all this tonight. And that is the question of the spirit of this place. I think that's something that is invaluable. Nobody can put a price on it, but each one of us that lives here and that visits here knows that that's why people love it here. And I think we need to be practical. I'm not a very practical person, maybe, but I think also when we're making these decisions, we need to really think of the spirit of this place that needs to be honored, respected, and also the spirit of our community. Where we put the city hall matters. And what we do at the Cannon Beach Elementary site matters. That we honor the tribe, the history, that matters. And it's, you can't put a price on it as far as dollars. So please don't forget this, any of us. And thank you so much.
Thank you, Jan.
Thanks, Jan.
Okay, is there anybody else in the audience? Okay. Oh, sorry.
You raise your hand as soon as you turn away.
They always do.
Michael Henderson, P.O. Box 1052. I had a question for the city council and the mayor. I was just wondering, since the last meeting, if you guys, I'm sure you have had conversations about what came of them. As far as the discussion that has been brought forth from the community as to paid parking.
Have we had discussions with people about it?
Amongst yourselves.
Oh, no.
No.
About generating revenue for the city through.
No. Since last week?
Yeah.
No, we have not.
Okay.
We have to.
We're going to.
Yeah.
We're going to.
We would have had to have had a legally advertised meeting to talk about that.
Got it. Okay.
And have
people. Well, interesting enough. So 20 years ago, I think my memory serves me correct, Rich Mays was the city manager. Kurt was the mayor. I can't remember who all sat on the city council, but I was a part of an ad hoc committee to the city council to some projects pertaining to our local park. And I was just curious if in your discussions, when you entertain the idea of paid parking and the possibilities of it and generating revenue for the city to aid some of these projects, instead of looking at that as an opportunity versus taxation, if maybe you would consider an ad hoc committee to from community members willing to sit on that committee to entertain these possibilities.
Okay, that'll be part of our discussion. Thank you. Okay, anybody else? Dick?
Boy, it gets harder to get up
every day. We all understand.
Every moment it changes.
My name is Dick Bash, Limit 26 on the Met Seaside. And I am, in 3 minutes or less, I'm here to partially represent three groups, and that is the Clatsop Nehalem people, the students, families that went to school at the elementary school, and Lewis and Clark, and that history, because it is such an important place for many reasons. And, you know, the magic That's an interesting. I'm going to give it. But you know, it that is an important place. The spirit of it is incredible, as all of us know. And I think this project is really a diamond. You know, as far as what it offers to the community, what it offers to visitors. I think having it be a heritage facility and a heritage for tribal school history and Lewis and Clark, I think will bring in different kinds of people. You know, there'll be a shift in people's interest. And, you know, I hate to say it, but I think that $2 million, there are ways, and I think we need to start working on that. There are ways of getting that funding outside of the city. At least to supplement it, because there are grants available for many of the cultural items. And I guess lastly, it takes the people, the residents and the visitors back to the land. When you look at the Heritage Garden, it really, and the other designs, it really takes people back to the land of knowing what the plants are, knowing their uses, giving them that information so that they can identify things and tell their grandkids, that's a so-and-so. And so I guess I was going to say I don't envy your decision, but in a way I do, because you're going to be voting on a really, really spectacular program and offering to not only Cannon Beach, but the world, but to many other people. So thank you.
Okay, anybody else in the audience? Okay, Zoom.
Yeah, we got two.
Okay.
One's Todd.
Okay. Hey, I raised my hand. I wasn't sure if Richard was going to speak. I'm Todd Lawson, a member of the Class of Malem people. And real quick, being an architect and doing public art and the like, I just want to stress the importance of not relying fully on the grants and the efforts of the people. This is a world-class operation and it needs a good starting point and a good place to hang a stage for the spirit or for the magic. And just to rely on grants, that would be years in the making. We would lose the opportunity. We've got an active tribe participation right now. We've got the people behind us. I've never heard anyone speak against us as far as like being included in the process or being represented on the site. And I just think now's the time to think about creating a fund that would go along with any of the 4 to 6 versions that is dedicated to the history of all the people and the site. And nature, it would be a loss not to just ride on this momentum. Thanks very much.
Thank you,
Todd.
Got Randy.
Okay. Go ahead, Randy.
Randy Neal, P.O. Box 1092. I submitted a letter. It was probably pointed at trying to get information like what got presented tonight. So I'm going to veer from that a little bit, but I still would like to refresh a couple of quotes. One was Mayor Barb, you know, a few weeks ago, our are we all in shock or what? You know, and then it was followed by a several of ha-has of some type. And then I was impressed by, you know, Mayor Sam, who basically stood up and said, the CBE is too much. It's time to really discuss the reduction in scope. And we desperately need to look at the operations or the operator. You know, I was very encouraged all along of every time I saw these designs that, boy, I hope we, you know, I hope it's close to budget so we can move along with this. But, you know, like everybody else, was shocked when it comes in two or three times X. I think there are, you know, I'd like to tag along with Sam's comments tonight. I think there are many different options that can be cut and pasted. I think there are questions that I have after seeing, you know, what's in two and what's in three and what's in four. I also understand that, you know, I've participated in system development charges discussions, and I know in the master plan for the parks is $1 million that are being funded by an SDC on every new development in town. And I believe that's one place to fund the landscaping and or fund the landscaping over time. You know, I have also been part of the TSP discussions. So I'd like to point out to people who may not have been that the city just spent a year and a half or so going through transportation options, parking discussions, and basically decided not to include anything in that TSP for paid parking, nor included anything for additional parking with the, you know, with the possible exception of maybe an employee parking lot someplace. So that's an issue out there. I was disappointed when the city came and asked for a waiver for the school project for parking, because I had suggested that they get instead a mitigation plan that, yes, you don't need parking for all of those people, but we should have the, you know, have this project also help either promote or fund or whatever a bus route through the system. And that way people can get to and from this facility using a bus, you know, one of which we already have funded. It's just not very well utilized. So I think there's lots of things that can be discussed. I'm not sure that we're at the point to be able to really discuss them yet. I'm glad to see the City Hall, you know, end up towards Southwind. I think that's a good long-term strategic use of Southwind. But we also know that we have many other strategic problems. You know, the transportation plan has $10 million worth of projects to deal with tourism related issues. We all know that there's affordable housing issues that need to be solved. So there's a lot of other projects that don't have clear funding sources yet. And I'd hate to, blow our wad trying to do these three projects simultaneously. So my suggestion would be that we do some type of fast track hackback on the CBE scope, coupled with a good understanding of what can be phased or what could be granted. You know, one of the things I heard tonight was, you know, the city pitching in to cover the food pantry. You know, I might suggest let the community pitch in and do the food pantry and let the city do the asphalt resurfacing or something like that. I think we're all interested in making sure this is successful. But I'd like to see that move along fast and we get a scope that we all believe in and can do. Unfortunately, the school project led to such a confusion or escalated budget that I think we should do a little slowdown on the police department and make sure that we don't run into the same problem. But I think it should continue to move forward on a good basis. On the City Hall project, you know, it might make sense just to put that on hold for a while. And understand, you know, and get all our energy.
Randy, you need to wrap it up, please.
Sure, and just get all of our energies behind the school and the police department.
Thank you. Anybody else on Zoom? One more time for the crowd. Okay, thank you very much, everyone, for your kind and respectful presentations. And we'll start our discussions. Anybody like to?
Where should we start?
Let's start with the elementary school rejuvenation. If that's okay with everyone. Okay. Anyone like to go first?
Sure.
Okay, thank you, Gary. Always appreciate it.
I think there's a lot of support for this project, and I think it will be very good for the community. I agree that the magic is in those last couple of million dollars, but I also agree with some of the things that Sam said, that there are things that maybe even are better left for us to develop as a community. Honestly, I don't think they're going to make a whole lot of difference in that price tag. But if I had to make a decision on what we've looked at so far, I would say schematic design as presented minus, and start taking some things out of there that that we can work on as a community. I think there are some things there that could be phased in later.
Like what? Give me an example. Could you explain what you're thinking? Like what?
I think the Heritage Garden, as Sam pointed out, I think there's a lot of things as far as maybe the fixtures and things like fancy doors that we've talked about that, you know, maybe grant worthy. I think maybe things like even the story circle could be backed out of it. Certainly the longhouse structures that are part of the park.
Those are all.
But I really think as far as the facility, that there's not a whole lot to back out.
But you're backing out. I mean, you're potentially backing out all the historical, cultural, and native components. And I don't think that's such a great idea. I mean, personally, I don't. I think that that is part of the magic, not just the structure. I think that has a lot to do with what makes this project special and unique to our area. And the fact that we had that involvement of the tribes with this is a really unique opportunity. I don't think too many building projects have that advantage of having that involvement. And then to just back all that stuff out, right now I'm feeling all or nothing. That's how I'm feeling, you know.
I just think some of those things we could work on between parks and the tribe. And, but it feels, I don't think it's going to make much difference. So I'm not too far off where you're at. It's, you know, if we're going to save $100,000 or $200,000, you know, it may be worth getting it done.
My big fear when if we put some of the things on the back burner is that's where they stay.
Yeah, I mean, it's like when that. You do a house.
I've seen that many times in different organizations that I've been involved with. And it's not that you don't have good intentions. It's just, it just doesn't happen. And to save that small amount of money and then not have those things happen is would be a big concern of mine.
I have a question about, as Gary likes to say, process. If we get started on this and we develop a budget and go into debt service and get our loans for the school and so forth, and then we get a grant, do something. how do we apply that grant to do something that we have already gotten, that we're already paying debt service on?
I can get you an answer for that, talk to our financial advisor. Usually what happens is you use that to pay for your next debt service payment.
Okay.
And I'm not even sure how easy it would be to pull it out, but let me get you an answer from them.
Yeah, that's what I'm, I mean, I think definitely there's a lot in there that we can get grants for.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we can go to cultural organizations, we can go to the NEA, we can go to a lot of the, places nationally and locally and regionally to get grants and wealthy benefactors here. But I'd like to know how we take that money then and apply it to something that we've already started the paying process on.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be surprised if we can't.
We can. I just want to know how.
Yeah, I agree. I'd like to know.
I mean, too.
I've had similar thoughts about acquiring enough money to start moving on this project and then filling in with the supplemental funding. So I'm not sure how realistic that is. Obviously, it's nice when you can just use one funding source and get everything up front. But I'm curious about that as well.
And I might have some information for you. We've already done one bond issue, and it was for like 4.6. I think we're down to maybe about 4.2 or 4.1 as far as the funds available. But you also, never mind, I won't go there.
Well, and we are supplementing this with, or at least options are to supplement it with some tourism and arts fund money. There is a residual from the current TLT that are all part of the plan, or could be part of that funding plan to keep any tax increases, Gary, hopefully to a minimum.
And Gary, to your point, that 231 is recurring.
Yes.
Not a one time.
And there was also the RV park, or was that mainly part of City Hall plan you were looking at?
I don't know which project we put in. I think we did put in City Hall, but there's funds. There are funds that are left over after the operation, and the staff has used those in either to supplement the general fund or maybe other projects or things. So we just put in a small amount as something that would be possible. And you're doing the budget every year to say, yes, we need these funds and we have these funds. So let's use this 100,000 or whatever for that.
And to Tim's point, I mean, I think that if these numbers are anywhere close to accurate, I think there's probably some supplemental funding there.
Mm-hmm. That brings up a question I have to Lori. Every year I think I have asked, and I didn't ask this year, the auditor about how many months of funds we have in case something happens and we aren't bringing in revenue, and how many months of funds do we need?
Probably about 4 months.
How many months do we have?
I don't recall here. From our last audit report dated June 16th. To call off the top of my head.
I don't think he said, because that's something I always look for, and I don't remember. I didn't ask, and I don't think he said. Would you find that out for me? I'm just very curious to know how many months we have for reserves, how many months we need, and where we stand in that case.
This is the question that I've asked as a budget committee member.
Okay, Tim. Thank you. Well, we'll get the answer. Thanks.
I mean, if these numbers are correct, it feels like we have a full year.
Well, I'd like to know what the auditor says about it.
If you're looking at that bigger number, I guess it's more like 3 years.
Yeah.
I mean, expenditures, what, 9 million plus current fiscal year budget for expenditures? That's my question. Is that close?
Well, we're going to be meeting with Mr. Rainey either this week or early next week to kind of go over and see where his figures are coming from.
You know, another concern I've had too is thinking about the project, you know, the beautiful project, you know, the whole enchilada. That, to me, that would attract people. That would attract business. It would attract people who'd want to use it. I, myself, just a revamped school building, I don't see how that's going to attract the kind of commerce that we would need to keep this thing running. And I didn't grow up here, so I don't have an attachment to the school building per se. As a building, just objectively looking at it, doesn't have any magic for me. But when I see those drawings, it has an incredible amount of magic because of all the other components. If I was going to have a celebration or something, I would want to come to that building that I look at on the screen. I wouldn't come to the school that was just refurbished with three classrooms and a gym and nothing happening, no spirit. I just wouldn't. And so I'm wondering, you got to look at it from an economic point of view too, is of selling the place. And having people want to use it. And I don't see how they would want to if it didn't have that special something.
I think there'd be some real question as to whether we could call it a tourism event center or a tourist
community hall.
Facility.
Right. That's when it's a community hall. Yeah.
I want to pull my comment back a little bit based on those what we may have as cash reserves, because I think that's more appropriate in the discussion for City Hall, those unrestricted funds.
Yeah. Brendan?
Well, I'd like to add something that's, I guess, in a different direction, and it's something that we as a previous council decided. And I feel it's put us at a bit of a disadvantage, and that's how we would like to address the complete lack of parking. And it's just something that hasn't been talked about. I'd like to discuss it. Gary and I spoke and talked about what Randy had mentioned about figuring out some type of shuttle. And I'm all for that. And haven't heard anything else other than people are just going to park wherever they're going to park, which I don't see as being a particularly beneficial to the neighborhood and to the running of this facility. If we're going to do what we, you know, are talking about, is having large groups of people there, where are they going to park?
I'm not necessarily a big advocate for a 2% raise of the transient lodging tax. I would love to keep that as low as possible. But using those numbers, 2% increase in TLT will create 962,500 of new dedicated tourism reinvestment dollars, restricted dollars. That's 793,750 more than what we need to complete school. I think that maybe there's a shuttle in there. But I think bottom line on anything like that is we need engagement with lodging, and we need buy-in from lodging on if we've got this big pile of money, I want to have their buy-in on how we would spend that. Mm-hmm. But I think their shuttle, I also did a little parking count on the parking surrounding the facility. And there's a lot of spaces on the street. It's also a quarter of a mile to Second Street parking, all the parking on Second Street. And it's just over a quarter of a mile to Spruce Street parking. So I don't know about everybody else, but I've been to concerts and sporting events, and I've certainly walked a lot longer than a quarter of a mile to get to the door.
Yeah.
That was after you paid for parking.
Yes.
And then walk.
Yeah, $25, $50.
Right. Yeah.
And I don't have any problem with that. I'd just like to come up with some type of plan that we can translate to the public so that it doesn't appear that we just want to build this building and don't care at all where people park. I'm all for walkability in this town. That's my preferred way to get around. But
well, no, when you're done, Brandon.
I guess I'm completely agreeing with you. I just want to come up with something that.
And I'm agreeing with you, I guess, and Randy, that if we could get to a shuttle, boy, we used to have one.
We still.
And we gave it up.
Partial.
We still have it.
Well,
right, we do in the summer.
We have diminished.
Yeah, we have service through the county or the transportation.
Something that's specific to that event, not just, you know, accelerated shuttle service throughout town. I think it would need to be something that specifically was for tailored to the event that was happening.
And we can do that with Sunset Empire.
But depending on whether they can, staffing issues has always been huge, but I think that's a direction that we need to go, is a robust shuttle, and not just for the school building, just everywhere in town.
I agree with the statement, absolutely.
Yeah, I do too. Yeah, they can get drivers.
Right.
That's the situation. To Brandon's point, one of the things that we're looking at is, I guess, in incentivizing or driving people to walk, to do more walking. As Gary says, it's 0.2 miles to the parking places that are down on Second. And you've got this beautiful walk through the park, and you come out and then there's the facility. And if we time the events, that's a, like later in the afternoon when those parking places tend to be more empty. There's something that's like, again, it's a 0.2 mile walk from that location. So we're trying to do more of those kind of things. And we don't, I don't know who will be managing the facility, but I think it's a disservice to the city if we have, like, we're bringing people there during prime time. It's like, if, you know, during prime time, it's set up, it's you can, you know, see things on your own. You can shoot a basketball, you can walk down to the water. And then, but in the evening hours, when there is more parking available, you know, we do that. And then it's, I don't know if it was you or which one of you was talking, I get confused easy. But I think we can work things out with the Sunset Empire, because what we're trying to do will be off hours. So maybe they have a better chance of finding a driver during that time. And Gary, we will reinstitute that bus that just kind of drives through the town when they have a driver. We fund it every year. So it's funded. It's just they said we can't do your route. So maybe things will change on that end.
Well, it is possible to go back to what we did in the past before we contracted with Sunset, is to have a dedicated staff driver.
Mm-hmm.
Paid for out of general funds.
Mm-hmm.
We did.
Yeah.
If we're going to seriously start looking at funding as a, you know, I hope we look at various funding sources. I hope we can identify various funding sources, and I think we have found a few. But if we're seriously going to look at lodging tax increase, I believe we should start looking as soon as possible at kind of a robust public discussion with the lodging industry before we make any kind of decisions. You know, I would like to think that their buy-in is possible, and listening and understanding their concerns, I think, is part of that.
You mean a public meeting? You're talking
yes, about absolutely. Meeting. Oh, yeah, let's.
Yeah, right.
Definitely a public meeting. The public is invited as well, but I would like to make it something where maybe we could meet with three local representatives of the lodging industry. You know, I think, you know, people like Patrick Nofield and Greg Swedenborg, maybe Doug Neely, kind of representing their interest in letting us interact with them would go a long way to getting us there and actually listen to their concerns.
I had a meeting after that meeting, and the person explained
which mentioned.
Yeah, which yeah. And I think the individual made really good points. And that was that we really don't understand what happens when we take this kind of an action and then somebody else has to implement it. And there are things that it's possible, you know, I suggested once I heard what some of the issues were that we could do to make it easier. For example, when we make it effective,
yes.
When, how far out we push it in terms of before they have to start collecting. If somebody already has a reservation, do they have to go back and try to collect the difference on that? But by working through some of those things, it, you know, it might not make somebody love it, but it'll say, okay, at least you listen. And frankly, there probably is some points in there that we have no issue over to make it easier. But if we don't understand it all, and Gary's meeting will help us to do that, that I think that can help. It was the indication that I got.
I think they also need to have a say or a voice in if we're generating a lot more of the restricted tourism dollars, the 70% of 1% that we keep talking about, that maybe they have some great ideas about how we could use those that they would be happy to see implemented. Okay. And we're all working together.
Yeah.
I hope I'm not a dreamer.
Those concerns you were talking about, Bruce, I have this, that's the one thing that I thought was a really, learning thing for me at
yeah,
the meeting was how difficult it is to implement that. And I really did. I started thinking how you could do it to make it, you know, so it wouldn't affect future reservations, et cetera, et cetera. And I think all that is possible.
Yeah. And we had precedents for it. There was some modification made with at least one of the 1%. And we made a modification during the prepared food tax for somebody that had done, they book out like a year. And so we sorted that through and that worked out.
So I think that we all are in agreement that a meeting, public meeting with lodging
is representatives part of the process
and the sure. chamber is part of the process. And we probably need to do that
sooner rather than later.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Friday night is clear.
Okay.
I was going to say tomorrow night, but it's not.
Yeah, Friday night. Yeah. Saturday night.
Just do it in your place. Huh? We'll do it. We'll just do it at the play.
Yeah.
During halftime.
We'll just do it in the poster. You're going to mention.
Okay. We will set that up. We have some dates from you that are, if you said we're available, I think out of the many that we tried, we ended up with one, but we'll try to make that happen. The chamber has often said they prefer morning meetings. So that might make a difference. I don't know. So we will make that happen quickly. And then I would also ask that if we're done with the chamber, with that, I'm sorry, with the CBE, you talked about what you want to do next with the City Hall project.
Well, are we done with the CBE? Have we actually come to any decision regarding how far we want to go, or is that a discussion for another time? Or
I thought that it was after the meeting that we were talking about is when that conversation would happen.
Yeah. I don't know that we need to wait. I think I haven't heard necessarily from Brandon or Nancy, but it sounds like I've said the full project, the schematic design as presented. And again, I see some things that could possibly be backed out, but essentially I'm saying the schematic as presented.
And I, that's not what you said, but now you agree with that now more, that whole enchilada.
I still see some things that could potentially be backed out, but I think you and I are,
but not major.
Not the whole heritage aspect of it.
Oh, no.
Okay. Right.
And I feel the same way. I think we spent, I think the process that we went through with community outreach was unbelievable. The work with the tribe, I never thought would happen, and it did. And to me, that's part of the spirit of the whole project, is how well we with CETA's help have captured what our community wants. And then it came in at a much bigger price, and we all, you know, took a look back. But I think the magic is worth that for me.
And I just want to say, I'm not like flipping about the money. I'm scared to death about it. Well, I really am. But I think we can do it. I think from discussions that we've had that it's possible.
Yeah, I go along with what you're saying. I think we really have to look carefully at the budget. We have to look carefully at what we're doing, and the cost of each item is just like, you know, remodeling our house. We have to look at every bloody item. But we also have to remember that it is a tourist related facility, and by just, you know, cleaning up the and putting, you know, making the classroom seismically stable and cleaning up the gym and putting a new floor in it, that is not going to be a tourist related facility. And then we really do have to look at the budget in terms of where do we get the money, because it won't be tourism funds that we use. And we're already using tourism funds to buy the building. So we're pretty much committed to making it a tourist related facility. I think, and the heritage that we have here in this area, Dick is right. This could be a world-class facility. At least it could be a facility the community can be proud of. And that's what we really want to see there.
I agree with everything everybody said. In order to make my decision, I'd like to feel better about where the money is coming from. Versus, I want to do this and the money will somehow happen. And so far, I see some very positive avenues to make that happen. And I'm more than willing to discuss it, move forward with it, and exactly what we're all talking about, you know, on this. One thing that I heard this evening that seems to conflict with what the information that you'd given us, Bruce, about property taxes.
Mm-hmm.
And what I got from the email that you sent us was that our millage rate was about 6 cents per thousand.
Yes.
0.065.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
So if you extrapolate that with the example that you gave at a $500,000
the value of a $500,000 home, mm-hmm. they pay about $32 a year.
I believe that was it per million.
Okay.
Yeah. Per thousand.
Right.
Per thousand.
I think, and that conversation seems more appropriate in talking about City Hall too.
Mm-hmm. Not just to raise property taxes to cover.
Right. I don't know if that's what those numbers were meant, but I mean, to have taxpayers pay everything for City Hall is obviously a ridiculous proposal, you know. You know, to expect know
it's ridiculous, it's just probably not.
It is for our community, I think.
People can't afford it.
But you know, to have the community pay something. I mean, we all want a City Hall, but nobody wants to pay anything. You know, I presented numbers which have kind of got twisted around, I think, a little bit, but taxpayers currently pay for between 10 and under 11% of our general fund, and tourism pays for 68%. And that number goes way up when you start adding the other visitor-related income, like food tax, like the especially the restricted portion of the TLT, the short-term rental licenses, the business licenses that are mostly tourism related, puts us up into 80%. So, you know, if residents spent 10% of the cost of the City Hall, that seems like that would be a fair and reasonable expectation. But obviously how we got there would be another question. If we could get there.
So is everyone comfortable with moving on to Ruth?
Sorry. I'm very glad to hear what everybody has said, but we really haven't made a decision yet until we plug the gap from the funding side on that project. And we can, if we do look to property tax revenue, then it's probably going to be a GO bond, which means it'll have to be a referral, which means that we won't be able to go ahead and tell the bond company or anybody else that we're ready to go until after November. Then it'll be some time after that before we actually see collections. So just understand there's a real time gap on that. Now that's something that depending on how we do it, you could go with a different funding source on a short-term basis and then fill it with taxes after maybe we do the referral in a year or two or something, you know, more. But that's something that you could do. But we that's if we're going to use the property tax, I'm quite sure there'll be a referral involved. And there's time.
I apologize again for jumping us ahead because it's keeping these two projects with separate funding sources separate is challenging for all of us. I'm assuming a lot of people listening and trying to follow this process as well. But that would certainly be a City Hall thing.
I would say we need to have the TLT meeting.
Right.
Really, very, very soon.
Jen, what was the first date that we had that was available, Council?
April 18th, and that was the one we used as a stated date for the wetlands meeting with the Planning Commission. Yeah. So we were going to look at date options for project meetings because I thought we'd want to meet sooner than the 18th.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. So the chamber, we check with them for a morning time or something?
I can check with the chamber for morning time.
Jim's here.
Okay. All right. Thanks, Jim.
But are you thinking of morning time?
The general members are different than the lobbying. The morning time is better for our board members, is what Bruce is referring to.
That's what I thought.
Because they're across all sections of the business community. Lodging group might have a better time that suits their needs.
When you do that, could you give us a variety of dates? Because we all have things. It's hard to
find. It would be good if the chamber and the lodging meeting was at this at the same time. I was thinking of it as, I don't know if we're thinking of two separate meetings.
Oh, no.
Yeah,
no.
One meeting.
We're having the chamber facilitate with the lodging operators.
Okay.
Working with you and as much information as we can get for them to prepare their questions and thoughts and everything. Too. So I can coordinate with Bruce and you guys on how, what they might need. So they'll probably have questions too about what we're going to talk about. Because
right.
An agenda for that would be good and discussion points would be good as well.
And again, I would like to see that as a small panel that kind of represents the interest that we can go back and forth with rather than being a big free-for-all.
But it would still be a public meeting, so any lodging.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Could still make public comments. And
right. Yep.
Yep. Happy to help facilitate.
But is everyone wanting to do this next week or?
As soon as possible, I guess. Because we need to move, we need to get moving on this.
How long do you need, Jen, to get some?
Well, I got to reach out and get them together and find out.
Okay.
So, with what 2 days left this week, that's going to be kind of short notice.
And, so I would say let's just try to get it within the next 2 to 3 weeks.
Yeah, I'll reach out and see about how fast I can get the word out and get an answer for you guys.
Yeah, beyond my commitments next week, already commitments, I don't think next week is going to work.
And it sounds like we probably need a little more time to get everybody prepared.
So sometime the week of the 17th, yes.
Yeah, at least 2 or 3 weeks, what we're talking about.
Okay.
Looking at daytime.
Right.
Okay.
Unless you tell us otherwise.
Right, yeah.
I'll ask all those questions.
Okay, sounds great. Thank you.
Hey.
Okay. how about if we take a 3 minute, sticking with the theme, 3 minute break, and then we'll come back and talk about City Hall and the police station.
Thanks.
Okay, thanks everyone.
Let's get this done.
The break is over. Audience. We're starting. Dad?
What?
We're starting our meeting again. You're welcome. Thank you. Okay, we're going to call the meeting back to order.
The cool teacher has declared.
Yeah, the cool teacher has declared. We're starting again. Okay, so now we're moving to City Hall and the police station. And I think it might be beneficial to start out with the question of siding and get our thoughts out on those.
Well, I have
a topic. Let's start with.
I have a real strong feeling about that. So
okay.
I really cannot imagine the City Hall being at the cache site. I think that would take away from the whole purpose of City Hall, which is a central place where people can come. They can come to, you know, they can come to a meeting. They can come and talk to the city planner. They can come and look at you know, make a request to see building plans. They can do all kinds of things, and they can walk to City Hall. And I understand the practicalities of it and the money part of it, and I get that. But even if it means, I know no one's going to like hearing this, but even if it means putting off, I mean, this, the police station's a given, it has to happen, period, fast. But if it means putting off or postponing City Hall for a while so that we can have it at this site, then it's worth doing it if we have to do that for financial reasons. And I think it's that important that it's in the center of the community. That's my piece.
When you say wait a while, define that.
I don't know. I mean, that's the waiting till we know that we can finance it and don't have to go into irreparable debt to do so.
Yeah. Problem is you're going to be chasing the inflation.
Yeah.
And like right now, it's a $3 million difference. And I don't know what's going to happen that in, say, in a year, that if there was like almost no inflation and projects costs went down, they went down. But if they we stay on a similar pattern to what we're on now, if they, most likely the project cost is going to go up, not down. And so, and potentially the borrowing costs.
That's
the problem.
I know. I understand that. But we actually don't know what's going to happen to the market. We really don't, you know. And I'd be the last person to ask for advice on that. So, you know, I mean,
yeah.
I'm just saying we don't know. It's an unknown. And it's, and it would be risky.
Yeah.
But, it, you know, if it's going to be risky to build them both in separate places at this time, then there's risk either way.
I do like the idea of taking them one at a time as well, and starting with the police department EOC at the gas site. I still wrestle with the siting of City Hall. You know, obviously cost savings, convenience savings, not blocking our Haystack Rock parking lot for a year. I think we had pretty robust comment on siting, public comment on siting, and it seemed like it was kind of split 50-50. I don't know if I just made a guess of people who I want it here and people who say I want it out of the tsunami inundation zone. I think possibly that putting the police department EOC out there might convert some of those people to saying that I'm okay with City Hall here. I also think about the possibilities for this site if we did put it up there. I'm not even sure where I'm landing on this right now. So I'm interested in hearing from everybody else. But what we could do in Midtown, if this was not here, I think we could have some nice improvements. I mean, I would love to see something more plaza park like on the corner of Hemlock and Gower and let the parking run up this way. We might actually gain in parking. So I see some advantages to both. And I'm not going to decide until I hear from you guys.
Oh, that's a team player.
You guys can sway me.
It wasn't necessarily a gutsy move, but it was gutsy to say.
Yeah.
Well, I am favoring moving the City Hall and the police station up to the cache site if the soils hold it. And that's the big question right now. We can't really make a decision on it at all until we know whether the soils are even going to hold it. Or the landslide situation. But I mean, I see a problem with, first of all, the idea of the City Hall being at the heart of the city. I think at one time it was. I don't think that it is necessarily now. I mean, how many people do? I mean, I know Jan walks to the City Hall, but I don't know that everybody else walks to City Hall. And what do they walk here for? That's another question. If we had a plaza out on Hemlock and Gower, I think more people walk to that and be able to have more of a gathering spot than they actually would have here in City Hall. But the other part of that is too, is as I understand it, and again, forgive me if I'm wrong, we'd still have to raise City Hall at least a story. Because of the tsunami situation, and we'd have to raise it again to keep the essential offices down from the first story. Maybe we wouldn't have to raise it a story, but it would have to be tall, which means that it wouldn't be part of the neighborhood. It'd be out of proportion to the neighborhood that we have here. It's going to be cheaper to move it to the cache site. We could do something with this lot, whether it's add more parking or sell it or whatever, and put the proceeds toward the cost of the city hall. I just think that there's a lot more advantage to doing the construction there. We wouldn't have to move people. We wouldn't have to go to a $250,000 cost of moving people out of City Hall while it's being reconstructed, and we wouldn't have to pay for the demolition cost. So I think there's a lot of reason that we need to seriously consider putting it on the cash side.
Nancy, I don't know where I didn't hear that it would have to be tall. I heard it would have to be tall if it had to be tsunami proof, but that it doesn't have to be tsunami proof. It only has to be level 4 seismic and therefore would not have to be tall.
So the current pricing as presented represents a single story structure on grade for the City Hall.
Even with an EOC?
The EOC would be associated with the police department. There would be in the City Hall a room similar to this one with EOC capabilities.
Pile of stuff.
Of an earthquake, but it would not be built to withstand a tsunami. So it would be built to category 4, the highest risk category for seismic and wind events. But in the case of a tsunami, it would be significantly damaged. So there is a risk associated with that.
And that's the other thing that I've heard too, is that, you know, people, when we had the outreach, people would come in and say, don't build a City Hall in a tsunami zone. And that's exactly what we would be doing. And if it is at grade, it would be lost in a major tsunami. And yes, it only happens 18 times in 10,000 years, but it does happen. And we would lose the entire City Hall. What would we have left? We'd have the police station at the cache site and any backup materials or departments or personnel that we would need to recover from a tsunami would be gone. So those are some of the reasons I would put it at the cache site.
So if we just build a City Hall on this location, it does have to be built to category 4. Just the seismic category 4.
To seismic, our current plan and pricing would be to build it to category 4. There's not a code requirement to do that.
Okay. We could build a little stick shack.
So if it's just a City Hall with no emergency operation component, it could be a category 2 standard office building.
How much does it add to the cost to build it to a category 4?
Go ahead. In new construction, I mean, it is a cost, but it's not a significant cost because you're already building it anyway, right? You know, when you go back and retro a building into category 4, that's more expensive. 3% maybe, it's not a huge cost. But I could look into that if you wanted more detail.
Yeah, I think we could look on that.
But again, we're talking seismic, not tsunami, category 4.
Correct.
Okay. So the height is not an issue.
One story.
Yeah. We did an initial analysis of putting both programs here, and that's when our building started growing because we needed to get that EOC up on the top floor.
But that's what your current pricing is, the category 4 single story at this site.
Correct.
That's seismic category 4.
That's right.
Yeah.
Correct.
Seismic. So I have really mixed feelings about moving City Hall up there. I, you know, initially when we bought Southwind, you know, you guys all know my dream about what that was going to be. So I've had to adjust my dreams. And, but then I also look at, if we were to move both of those facilities, would this be a good place for workforce housing? And
I had that thought too.
Yeah. And I mean, that's something we have to address. And with very little buildable space in the city, this would be an ideal place for people to live and work in Cannon Beach. Well, that probably wasn't much help. Saying it out loud didn't make it any easier, but I'm really torn.
We're in the same place.
Ripped apart.
And then?
Well, I've always advocated for this location for a city hall, and I still feel that way. But to Nancy's point, you can't argue with the cost savings. And it's real dollars to have both the city hall and police station EOC built at Southwind. And
cash site,
exactly. I still feel that the city hall would be best built here. I would love to have workforce housing in this location. I don't know. Sure how to complete that thought. I guess I'm agreeing with you, Barb. I'm torn, but I think this is the best location.
Sounds like we've got one here, one cash site, and three undecideds.
The easement issue was something I hadn't thought about for a long time.
Left investment.
Sam, okay. And you're going to let us know on that.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I didn't
the property owner.
Answer Bruce.
Oh, I said, we'll investigate that.
Okay.
Yeah, I never, this first time I've even heard.
Yeah, I did a long time ago, but it was back there. Who's the property owner?
I don't know who it is. I know that they're still represented by the same company, but I think somebody has bought out the teachers union. Pardon?
Being Capital.
Okay, yeah.
So the former, also formerly known as Greenwood.
Yes.
Okay. And
I think Greenwood still is. Jan, is Greenwood still Greenwood? Because they're managing it for that Capital company.
It's Lewis and Clark. I mean, they're changing.
Oh, that's right.
Okay.
And it's very complicated. So
yeah. Okay.
They all kind of go together.
Right, okay. Right. Okay.
Complicated.
All right, thanks.
I feel like because of some of these changes, as in we know we have to put the police department EOC there.
Oh, absolutely.
It does kind of change the picture that a lot of people haven't wrapped their heads around. And I would certainly like to hear more public comment on siting of City Hall and see where we land with that now that we have emergency operations in a safe location. So I don't know, I keep coming back to, well, let's take care of police department and emergency operations, and can we slow our roll? Yes, I realize it is probably gonna cost more. Financing, who knows? Are you still there? Maybe
yeah, I'm
something roll on.
I am, just because I need to know if we can afford it,
yeah.
Or what we can afford, or what we really need. I know that Manzanita is building a new city hall now, and I know that they're I know that they're building one, and I don't know what the size of it is or any details on it. I'd like to know. You okay?
Yeah, that was
fun. You want
to
pat him back here?
Okay.
Okay. So I'd love to see some comparisons with another community. I don't know how much size-wise, Manzanita is similar to us in some ways. I'm just curious where they're doing theirs and what it's going to cost them, City Hall, and what they have in mind. I'm just curious, that's all.
Yeah, I can get that information because I've been working, we've been talking back and forth. They have a site that is out of the tsunami zone.
It's out of it?
Yes, they do. There's some questions about whether or not some existing structures there could be retrofitted, similar to what we're doing here. So they watch our project too.
So what phase are they in?
They're right about where we are.
Oh, okay. I thought they were further along.
They had a vote on it, didn't they? Didn't they have a vote on it?
Yeah, I thought they did, and I thought they had a price.
people voted against that. And
I don't think so, because I went to a meeting relatively recently and they were still talking.
I mean, this has been going on for years. Right.
Yes, okay. Yeah.
Are they anywhere close in size to us as far as your budget, size of City Hall?
No.
I think they were
not much smaller.
I think their structure was 5,000 to 8,000, including a police station, but they only have a couple officers.
But shared with three communities.
Oh, that's the fire department.
No, their police department is shared with.
Oh, yeah.
Sure. Wheeler and Anita and the unincorporated area in between.
Yeah. And I don't know how, if the three communities were moving in, because they did talk about at least a part of the structure that was going to have to be, I don't know why it would have to be risk category 4 for tsunami. You know, I really don't know. I'll call the city manager down there and find out, because they were thinking that they were out of the tsunami zone. Like we thought we would be a building okay. And so maybe they were in the large, not the extra large. I don't know what happened with that. I'll find out. I'll send you an email on it.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
I think everybody's on board to go with the, definitely have the police station be up there.
Yeah. I don't think we have a choice.
Right.
Yeah.
We have to.
Yeah.
What does the rest of council feel about, and I'm happy to hear other feedback too, on getting that project going and slowing down City Hall portion?
I'm not in favor of slowing down the City Hall, just because that's what's happened in every other council the last 20 to 30 years.
Yeah.
And that's why we're here now. And the price is not going to go down at all. It's going to go up, and it could go up significantly. So regardless of where it's built, I'd like to move forward with however we're going to do it. And keep the discussion about, especially about how we're going to fund it. I like your idea of about 10% for property taxes. I'm not sure exactly if that's practical, not practical. It's all predicated on how much we're going to need.
So you're saying slow both projects down until we investigate funding?
No.
Saying go forward.
Complete opposite.
Okay.
Madam Mayor? We really can't slow City Hall down until a decision is made where City Hall is going to go, because you can't do PD up at the cash site and then suddenly say, oh, we're going to go ahead and double or triple the size because we want to build City Hall there. So there has to be a decision before we can forward.
But if they were two separate building sites, then it would be more of an option. Still not a great option, because I agree, Brandon, it's going to cost more.
Yeah.
So do we take the big bite now? It's tough.
Yeah. First of all, nobody's going to fund the project for us if we don't know where the money's coming from, and if we're not in a good, solid financial position to do so. And it would probably be for all three projects, we would be looking at the same thing. And by three, I'm saying police and City Hall being separate now until we decide to combine them. So it's not a matter of us worrying about whether we can afford it. It's, with our bond rating and history and all those things, it's whether or not somebody's willing to go ahead and fund us. So that's the financial ability to build will be determined by whoever might give us money. So I don't know if we would ever reach that ourselves, or if we did, it wouldn't matter if somebody was going to take a really hard look at us.
Barb, you'd like to see it here, but
I think so.
You're the same as me.
Yeah, I really am. And you know, your point about public comment, I got to thinking, since we've known that the police station has to be moved because of the code change, have we had a public outreach about the topic of City Hall
location?
And I'm not sure we have. I mean, we've had our public comment in our meetings, but
it's always been the combined.
Right.
And it's been about the price mostly. It hasn't been as location has not really been. I don't feel like I've heard know what the public thinks about location as much as I know what they think about how much it's supposed to cost.
I know when we had the last outreach, and it was still, we still didn't know about the police station. It was pretty, there was quite an outcry about, you know, we need to keep it away from the tsunami zone.
But that was without knowing that the police station and the EOC was going to be up.
Right.
That's because people were thinking of there being a tsunami event and having the whole, you know, police station and EOC washed away. Mm-hmm. Now that isn't what we're concerned about. So that really changes the whole picture.
And I feel the community feels that we need to take care of the City Hall issue. That we've talked about it way too long. But we haven't really talked too much about location.
I think we need to have some kind of a public outreach for the siting of the City Hall.
Yeah. That would be good.
So in the next couple of weeks.
Jammies.
Have a special meeting. And that's what we're going to address.
I think that'd be very appropriate.
And then we would tell them, you know, we're going to get the police station where it needs to be.
Yeah.
And the EOC. And then this is going to be an office building. Seismic office building.
One thing I'm concerned about having the EOC, and I know that we need to do it, but I'm just going to express my concern.
Okay.
Having the EOC up there, when I think of what is going to happen in a tsunami, how are people going to get up there?
And how city staff is going to get up there?
Anybody.
There's no reason for them to get up there.
Yeah,
that's not what it's city staff. To go to the site is what that is.
EOC. The EOC needs to be operating the cache sites in different locations, gathering information. There, it happens if we build it up there, and the cache site remains the way that it is, then yes, they could come to that site, but that's the site they're supposed to go to now. But it would have nothing to do with City Hall.
No, but you're still going to have emergency, you know, you and other people are going to still have to get there to operate the EOC. There's no argument that that's where it has to go.
Right.
I'm just concerned that people are going to have a hell of a time getting it there.
It's a hike.
Well, yeah. Actually, we'll have probably as much a heart of a time coming down here if there's a seismic.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just we've all got to figure it out. I got a bike.
Yeah.
Andrew's got a bike.
You don't bike when your ground is down 6 feet and trees and
there won't be any biking.
Buildings are collapsed.
Husky tires.
Yeah, plan on a hike.
Yeah.
So special meeting.
So if you want to do a special meeting in the month of April in the evenings, we have no dates that work well for everybody on a Tuesday or Wednesday. Mondays are out, and Thursdays left in April, we're going to bump up against Design Review Board and Planning Commission.
Right.
So do you guys want to look at a day meeting, or do you want to look at May for night meetings?
We're trying to get public outreach, even though I was surprised when we had that 2:30 meeting. Here we have a few public citizens here.
Yeah.
But I think it almost has to be a 6 o'clock meeting, which never stretches too long into the nighttime.
And the other thing, if we go into May, we have more time to advertise to get people out. So we do have a regular council meeting on May 2nd, which is Tuesday. So May 3rd would be available. Now that week, you guys do have budget. That's a day meeting. So you'll have your council meeting on Tuesday, and Thursday you'll have your budget meeting during the day. So May 3rd and May 10th. So the first and second Wednesday of the month.
I can't do May 10th.
The 3rd?
Be good.
I can do May 3rd.
How does that work for you?
Just to throw out one more idea. We had one of our COE events on a weekend day for more public input. Is that something that Warren's looking at?
Saturday morning.
I'm not a big one.
Sorry?
I can't do.
Okay, so Randy can't do the third.
But the topic that we're going to discuss is a definite community. I mean, I think sometimes when we do Saturday meetings, it's to try to get second homeowners and things. Mm-hmm. I don't know if a Saturday meeting.
How quickly do we need to make this decision?
Well, I get confused by some of the information that we get presented, but there's a cost, escalation cost in all of these projects. And along the least expensive I've seen is about $7,800 a week. That's what it costs to, now that may be just during construction once you've got everything going, but there is a definite cost of delay. Because they assume so many weeks, so much per week could potentially happen, and they're covering themselves for it. So it's not a small amount.
I guess I'm a little confused. Are you talking about if we waited like 2 weeks to have an outreach meeting, it's going to cost us $15,000?
It depends on how the entire project goes, but a delay, there's a delay is not benign, and there's always going to be a cost associated with it. And I've tried to figure out what that cost is. I think on one note that I don't know if it was either Remick or Emmerich, but there was a 5% escalation per month.
0.5%.
Five. And I went and checked what that was.
That's just a fact we've on it for price increase of materials, and
that was like 450,000.
With the thinking it's going to start in next February.
But there's a cost, and I can't tell you exactly what it is because there's so many things affecting.
I'm just thinking of the bonding and all of that.
If it's 2 or 3 weeks, that's not going to make a big deal.
So we said the third's out.
The third's out.
For myself.
Yeah, okay. We need you here.
So if you want to do the following week, the week of the 15th, the only option would be the 16th, because that would be the third Wednesday of the month, and that's out. So we have Tuesday the 16th.
The 16th Tuesday?
Yes.
And did we rule out Leslie's idea of the weekend?
Oh, we didn't rule it out completely. I want to try to get as many community members here, and I don't know. I mean, community members that are also business owners. Saturdays aren't good.
Is there a day? Is Sunday better? Is Wednesday better? I mean, those people they're very busy.
Right.
So it's going to be a problem. We have tended to stay away from weekend meetings for the convenience of the council. It seems. I mean, intuitively to me, if you have something on a weekend, there are going to be more second homeowners.
I'm fine considering a weekend.
Yeah, I don't have a problem with it.
It actually makes it easier for me.
Okay.
My weekend I cannot do is the 13th and 14th.
Are we talking about May or April?
May. Yeah.
May 6th, but maybe we can look at earlier.
Well, the 22nd is Earth Day.
Can't do that.
29th might work.
We can do the 29th.
That's a Saturday, and the 30th is the Sunday.
Isn't that Memorial Weekend?
May.
Oh, that's May. Sorry. That's May. I was back in May.
Yeah.
So the 29th, the council chambers is available.
Gives us a couple weeks to advertise.
Let's do it.
What time?
I prefer late morning.
11.
Leslie, does that work? The Saturday?
Oh, we didn't.
I forgot to
brought up Saturday. So we didn't even ask you guys, but you're the one that brought it up.
Late morning. Actually, it could be afternoon too. But
it looks like either April 29th or May 16th both work for me.
Spoken for?
No, they both open. Work. Open.
What about May 16th, Tuesday night?
We're looking at trying to schedule it on a weekend to get second homeowners, which I'm not sure we get.
A lot of people work on the weekends.
I know.
I'm not going to be residents, full-time residents.
We can always use May 16th as a backup to base off of your for what you get from the 29th. If you feel you need another one, we can always go with May 16th.
I don't think I think we should go for one meeting. Yeah.
I like one.
Yeah.
I like April 29 just to get this thing rolling. And, you know, we can encourage a written public comment on a single question.
And the single question is going to be the siding. I mean, it's going to be pretty.
Where to put City Hall.
Yeah.
Can we get any kind of a community survey started?
I am reluctant to a community survey because you don't really know who returned the returns. I mean, somebody could do multiple times. It might be something somebody just throws away. I think that if we have things that if people write in, you know, I want this, that's fine. You're not likely to duplicate that same person's letter over and over. But the survey, I would do it with somebody that's got the ability to discern whether or not somebody is like pushing it one way or the other.
Jim, how much participation do you think we might get from from business operators and residents on a Saturday morning?
It's hard to say. If they're working on a Saturday, it's you know, the lunch rush. Check out for hotels, and you know, there's different factors for different businesses.
Yeah.
Between 4-10 is when most businesses open retail-wise. So that's typically why our meetings are held early in the morning. But
well, how much of our population are we talking about here that's a tourism business owner that as residents or even a tourism employee?
It would be using City Hall.
Is that?
They would be using City Hall enough to care one way or the other.
I think whenever we have the meeting, we need to have the residents of our community be available to come. Don't know if a Saturday or a Tuesday night is better.
No, I think we might need to do a follow-up meeting. I'm just thinking, I don't want to be here 120.
I don't understand why we're even, why the weekend? Who are we trying to attract?
I think we're just trying to get the meeting in earlier rather than later, but we can start looking at those May dates again.
Are we all free on the 16th? It's a Tuesday.
I know.
May 16th?
May 16th, because that's yes. 2 weeks different.
Right.
Difference.
Yes.
And that might help to get out the word.
I can do it.
Yeah, I can do it.
Leslie?
Yeah.
Okay. May 16th at 6 p.m.? And then when we do the flyer, we will encourage people, if they cannot attend, to feel free to email their thoughts on the site location.
We're not doing the Saturday, but we are doing the...
Right. We're going to have one meeting, one topic, and then all of our questions will be answered.
That was easy.
16th of May.
No, Leslie, are you saying you need an answer sooner rather than later on testing sites?
I believe we have our direction to go ahead with the cache site tech, the geotech movement, and this getting the survey there. So those, I believe we already have direction.
And we'd hold off on that for here, for this site.
That would be my assumption, unless you tell me otherwise.
Mm-hmm. So I think we need to have our community meeting before we...
One question I do have for previous community outreach events, we provided with our flyer questionnaire or survey invitation for input either before the meeting or after the meeting for people who couldn't attend. Is that something we would want to duplicate?
What kind of response did you get?
We got stronger response for the first COE, and the subsequent ones trickled somewhat, but we got a fairly strong response in writing compared to the in-person response.
I would think a single issue meeting with a simple question that we'd get a lot of written comment.
Yeah, if we publicized it.
So you say a survey would be helpful.
I don't think we need
that. I mean, not a survey.
Encouraging written comment.
Oh, just through our regular channels.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Hey, what other world problems do we need to solve tonight?
How to get home.
How to get home. Walk.
Before 9 o'clock.
Yeah, before 9 o'clock.
But I think we have to be really careful in this meeting that we make it very clear ahead of time for a written comment that the police station and the EOC are going to be at the cache site, period, out of the tsunami inundation zone. Mm-hmm. And that's that. Yeah, so that people can make a decision based on knowing that.
Right. And we'll put that, and then we can ask the question, where would you like City Hall, at the Gower Street or the cache site?
And so knowing that, where would you like it?
Right. But those are the only two options. I don't want to go down the trail of looking for we've done that way too many times.
Do we want to mention the cost difference?
Well, I think we have, I think that's out there. And we need to be as transparent as possible. So that would definitely be something that we would present in the meeting. That we do need to deal with the cost difference. Yeah, I don't think we want to hide it. Because what we're doing is we're asking the community, is it worth enough money to keep it here, to spend that money to keep it here? And that's a decision the community needs to make.
It would be nice to have that information in a packet well in advance.
Given that it costs more to separate them,
right?
But that the cache site, but the EOC and police station will be at the cache site. Where would your preference be? The location of the City Hall. Period.
You didn't put in the cost, and I think people don't have to go much past the cost. Why would I spend $3 million more if you're going to have the cost included in the information? I think you have some need to have something on there. Why it would make sense for it to stay here. Otherwise, you can almost predict what your results are going to be. If you only give out half the side of the discussion.
Right. You just say cost more. It will cost more to have it,
right,
to have them separated.
Right.
But knowing that, would you like to? I think it would be your preference.
Right. And I think those results are predictable unless you have something. I don't even know what it was that you would say, but that's I think perceived like, why would I spend more? So that I'm going to on a no vote side, why would I say, why would I say yes?
Because it would be here.
I know.
Where you can walk, where you can easily get to.
It's an accessible.
Yeah, but do you want to say that or just leave it that we'll put the information in?
Oh, because when do you stop editorializing? You know what I mean? It would be so, how do we?
I think where you stop, once you get into a survey or something like that, I think you do it in a way that is neutral enough that you're going to get people to thinking one way or the other, you know, on their own. But if you only give information on one side, like if we don't mention the cost and talk about how great it is to have a city hall everybody can walk to, then that would not be perceived as a fair,
right?
As a fair thing. So it's like, how do you counter that if you want to give that information?
I guess you could say nothing or just say, given that it costs more, would you rather have this location is accessible? Which would you prefer?
Right. Be part of the downtown, midtown, whatever.
Yeah. That'd be a good way to do it.
Another question, just playing devil's advocate tonight, I guess. Can we say, ask them, you know, which would you prefer? Why?
Well, we're not doing a survey.
We're not doing a survey.
No, I thought we'd determine.
We're not. No, we're just giving them the question.
Right.
That's going to be discussed, and they can write in what they think or show up and say what they think. We're not doing a survey.
So we're going to have an outreach meeting with the council.
Public meeting.
And there's only going to be one question. People can come up and say here or
right
there, and no more discussion about anything else.
They can say, they'll say why they, I'm sure each person will say why they prefer one or the other. I would assume they would. And I've never heard our folks in our town just go one word, you know.
So we're just basically here to hear, and
that's it.
And we're not offering any more information than that.
No, that costs more there, but it's more accessible here. We don't have any more information, really.
Yeah, we know the cost and some of the other answers. I mean, I'm just thinking, okay, somebody comes up and they ask a question of us and we're not going to give any answers?
If we have an answer.
We can at the meeting, can't we?
We can answer a question if we have an answer, but I don't feel confident that we'll have numbers yet.
Right, but we'll have seat to hear of our construction company or whatever you call them. Yeah, and we'll have us and Bruce and Lori.
But we can have a short presentation before, like we
right.
did tonight.
Yeah, kind of. I would think it's kind of similar to how we did it tonight.
Okay.
Except that there's going to be one issue.
You know, that doesn't solve the.
No, that's fine. If you sit up here and somebody says, you know, here,
yeah.
Somebody else says there, and we start making a tally, and I thought that's not going to happen.
No, we're going to have a dialogue.
Okay.
One thing I want to caution, and that's why I'm hoping, Bruce, you can get that information quickly. I've been hearing from people that the Manzanita City Hall, which is going to have everything it needs, is $6 million. I have no idea if that's true. That could be completely fabricated and untrue, or it could be true. I don't know. But I know that you need to know what that number is and why.
So and how many employees they have, and
right,
yeah, and their numbers have always been. I didn't have great faith in them compared to what we've had twice, and so I don't know.
It'd just be good to know.
I'll get all that I can,
because if people ask, I want an answer to that too. If that's true, I have no idea. Could be, you know, a rumor.
Where is it being built?
Manzanita.
Yeah. Where Manzanita?
You know where the grocery store is off the highway? Fresh Foods? Manzanita.
The street from the
Fresher and Pete's Pies. You know that, right?
The Thai restaurant.
Yeah.
Is that by?
It's right off the highway.
Big Wave Cafe. So
Big Wave 101. Big Wave is still there. But yeah, right along there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But before
we know what elevation that is?
No.
I was told that it's out of the tsunami zone, but we had several locations. It's the Lineta property, not Lineta, but they bought the property that's just south of Lineta.
I just don't see how that's out.
We had several sites that we thought were out too.
True.
And they all went away with this new ruling.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering about the apples to apples comparison.
I think it's going to be smaller. And they don't have as many employees.
Yes.
And they don't have the programs that we have.
They don't have the programs that we have. They don't have the amount of tourists that we have, although they do have a robust tourism economy. They also have a city limit that is smaller than what the town appears. For the north and the south, there's communities, but they aren't part of the city of Manson.
And the lodging tax must be dominated by vacation rentals.
Yeah, their budget is dominated by vacation rentals.
So
yeah.
Wheeler and Halem, they have their own city halls?
Yeah.
Yeah, they do.
I thought about that.
But not their own.
Okay, so I'll get that information as soon as possible.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anything else?
I have one question. I got a call from Leanne Thompson today. She was wondering if the city could or would do anything in commemoration of the family that has suffered so many deaths from car accidents, the one that just died. She was wondering if we would be considered doing something. She didn't say what. She didn't offer anything. She just wondered if we would take that.
I know Surfsam.
Federation.
Surfsam has done some things.
And there's a very robust GoFundMe going.
Yeah, on. I told her there was a GoFundMe.
And they're doing some raffles.
Okay.
With Hallmark and Surfsam lodging prizes. So I think there's a lot of community people that are going to be involved raising funds.
Okay.
Okay, anything else? Okay, thank you, everyone. Meeting's adjourned.
Thank you.